Nearly 2 years ago, Robert Randazzo, the CEO of PMDG, said something that went largely unnoticed by the community. He said that at PMDG, their money was firmly on Dovetail Games for the simming side and prepared for the enterprise side of their business. He said that they would shortly be adding X-Plane, as they did, to their repertoire, along with any other new dreamscapes or hypothetical sims that may prove themselves in the coming years. Was Robert right? Well, for the first time in 11 years, we finally see a entertainment-based Microsoft Flight Simulator back on the market. And it is next generation. Here are my top 10 reasons why Flight Sim World is the rightful successor to Flight Simulator X and the next generation Flight Simulator title. Microsoft-based flight simulators for entertainment purposes, we haven't seen a new one since FSX about 11 years ago. In fact, one hasn't even sold on the market for the 8 years preceding FSX theme. So there was a naturally massive void in the simmertainment market, which was largely created by this franchise to begin with. Over the last 35 years, the Microsoft Flight Simulator legacy and franchise has amassed the largest user base, the largest third-party developer base, the largest add-on selection, and Microsoft-based flight simulators remain the leading solution on the market, with users still flying the old FS9 platform and the latest re-release of FSX Steam selling over 800,000 copies, and it is still the largest commercially used flight simulator. In fact, it was largely kept alive over the past 7 years through commercial innovation. But now, the consumer has a new Microsoft-based flight simulator that is returning to not only provide simulation, but also entertainment. And for those reasons, this largely is the FS17 we've all been hoping for. Let's talk about the 10 reasons why. So first, it'll likely be done this year, and it's looking to look a lot like its cover art. If you remember, the Aces Studios tried to share with us a DirectX 9 versus DirectX 10 preview that was supposed to have been a vision realized before the Aces Studio was shut down. Unfortunately, that never happened, but Dovetail Games has given us a preview, and it's actually starting to look like what the community wanted. Look, Flight Sim World was the first to bring us SSAO, PBR, image-based lighting, to rework the old physics engine, add new global effects, including the most realistic rain and snow we've ever seen, and the first to give us a 3D cloud system in a Microsoft-based flight simulator. And it's clearly nicer to look at than any of its predecessors out of the box. But in early access, the only thing that it doesn't excel in is water in the ground environment. But of course, if you look at the rest of the experience, the way that they've improved the look and feel of aircraft, the way they've improved the look and feel of the sky, they'll equally be looking to improve the look and feel of the ground as well. To what extent? I don't know for sure, but I do know for sure that cloud and ground shadows will be coming and should be just as high quality as the shadows we see inside of the cockpit. The LOD will also be improved, and that's on top of a change that everybody can see now but largely has gone unnoticed. The accuracy of terrain is very much so improved over the old FSX engine in North and South America and Western Europe, for example. So they increase the resolution of the world model to height data every 90 meters in the updated part of the world, where previously some areas only had height data for every 1 kilometer. So on top of that, you have key areas like California that they go down to height data at 10 meter intervals. Hopefully this means that we are able to get even sharper terrain resolution and more believable sceneries on top of the obvious improvements that need to be made to the AutoGen model. Next, let's talk about effects. So effects, of course, are next gen as well. Look, I was critical of the snow when Flight Sim World released after seeing how nice the rain looked, but look at it now. We also just spoke about the rain. Of course, everybody's seen that before, so we won't elaborate too much, but let's talk a little bit more about the broader effects. So the way that the rain and the environment interacts, especially with True Sky, along with the aircraft, is legitimately terrifying at times. For example, watch me fly into this rain cloud. Now watch as the rain goes from bad to worse. As I get close to the cloud, you quickly lose orientation and find yourself in this kind of moving mass of moisture instead of just passing through 2D sprites. This brings us to our third point, the clouds and True Sky. True Sky is a little hard to describe, but if you think back to the complaints about the old sky texture system in Flight School and Flight Sim World, it's clear why they didn't spend too much time adjusting the colors much. The reason why is that True Sky completely strips the sky as we have known it for the past, 20 plus years, instead of using the strange system that uses these fragmented pixels to define ambient color, cloud shading, haze color, fog color using BMPs. The entire sky is now a massive volumetric skybox, as crazy as that sounds. So anything that isn't the ground and water textures is part of a massive atmosphere that uses the programmable GPU's power, like CUDA cores, in ways that we never imagined would be possible in this seemingly old platform. It is hands down looking to be the best looking sky in any civilian flight sim to date. Although right now, it's still not perfect. However, you get a glimpse of just how fluid clouds can be pretty soon. And I would expect hurricanes and tornadoes to be a real thing in the future. Of course, how you interact with True Sky is important as well. And we know that planes have been well on their way to being next gen. PBR has burst into the scene as a new thing in flight sims over the past couple of years. It's a technology that was widely demanded from the likes of those who use Grand Theft Auto V and other AAA titles. But with Stephen Hood being fresh off a career of Codemasters making AAA titles, he accomplished this early in flight school. But since then, it has gotten better and better. The shadows are outstanding, the internal lighting has improved drastically, and it is still not done. Of course, as of right now, we only have the default planes, but soon we will see third-party developers throw their PBR-capable aircraft in the sim, including jets. Now, we spoke about using the GPU more than ever, and it's true. Performance improvements continue to push some of these more demanding technologies to the GPU. So, for example, instruments and cockpit gauges have moved to DirectX instead of GDI. So, what used to be a performance killer, where complex aircraft would use old GDI technology and would render gauges on the CPU, they're now done completely on the GPU. And with True Sky, no more cloud-killing sprites in your pipeline to mess up performance when the weather suddenly changes. Whether it's a clear day or a complete thunderstorm disaster, performance holds up consistently. Now, every PC is not ready to run this thing at max settings just yet. But just as technology eventually allowed us to scale to FSX, it will with Flight Sim World as well. Hopefully even faster as we have an active development team. And the active development team is looking to put this in as many hands as possible, so it comes out of the box in a very high quality standard. Look, if you got Flight School for $15, then this was free. Even so, at $24.99 US, it's a steal now. The ratings have nearly hit 80% for the latest reviews, and they continue to climb. This is truly a title that you can just click and install and enjoy. No add-ons needed to get a great feel of what this thing can do. But, of course, we know the magic will always be provided by third-party developers. And once they start developing on top of this great base, the possibilities will be endless, as they should be in flight simulation. One of the most important parts of any flight simulator is user-created content, and more specifically, freeware. Now, Dovetail Games is doing something interesting here in that they're opening up the Steam Workshop to user-created content. However, as of right now, it's only missions. But it gives you a preview of just how easy it'll be to browse, subscribe to, download, and then use user-generated content. And I'm hoping that this trend continues in terms of usability and access for the freeware SDK. As of now, Dovetail Games has said that they will be providing a freeware SDK to the market. How deep and complex that SDK will be, we are yet to see, but at least it's a step in the right direction, and I hope that they continue to provide unlimited access to freeware developers. So, let's talk about that SDK. As I said, there's a freeware SDK that will be coming on the way, but the core SDK should also be available to all devs. And there's no mandatory need to sell through Steam according to Dovetail Games, despite some early reports and concerns. Now, this is still something I reserve for the third-party development community to affirm as time goes on, but for now it seems that Dovetail Games got the message that the development community needs access, not only to create products for our current needs, but also to help Dovetail Games develop tools for the future as part of the core sim. As of right now, the developers have told me that it takes a couple of weeks to convert a commercial product to a consumer one if needed. The core technology is still shared between Microsoft Flight Simulator titles, so a 64-bit future may be more unified than we originally anticipated. Now, one very important point in being able to future-proof the simulator is also ensuring that it breaks ties with some of the old hacks or workarounds that have been developed over the last 10 years. FSUIPC is arguably one of the most important add-ons, and it does basic things such as allows dedicated hardware support for more complex controllers. That's something that must be addressed, and Dovetail Games has begun working on their own SimConnect as part of the SDK as a way of ensuring that the core sim is as capable as devs and users need it to be. For right now, it's still not complete. Fortunately, there are programs like SPAD Next that fill that gap, but it must be addressed in the long term, and it seems as though Dovetail Games has started addressing it. And finally, probably the most important part is that we all have a voice. Look at how much action Dovetail Games has taken since the release of Flight School, nonetheless Flight Sim World. In just 3 months, there have been 9 updates. Martin Day came to us years ago in the midst of speculation and animosity and offered to listen and learn from the community. Of course, some received him better than others, but over time, others like Amy and Steven and now Chris have stuck with the community and have learned from some of their missteps and clearly seem to be in this for the long haul. It will take time for the broader community, especially some of the business community, to come around, and that's to be expected, especially considering how disruptive this seems to be to some of the old ecosystems within the flight simulation community. But regardless of that, the future still appears to be bright for simmertainment, and will likely return to the continued evolutionary development of next-gen titles for today and tomorrow alike. So was Rob right? Well, it appears he was. I'm not sure how he saw that vision, although of course he's a well-known insider, but they appear to have lived up to the hype for now. But still, they need to make it out of early access, they need to ensure that their ecosystem is fair and as open as possible, and continue to drive the great community experience that has been focused on keeping those with and without a logbook happy. Thank you so much for joining as always, and everybody take care. So was Rob right? So was Rob right? There we go.